Yes, before moving to the presentation, I would like to introduce Professor Satish Bise. So he has obtained PhD in pharmacology from Pitts Pilani in the year 1983. Before that, he did a master in pharmacology in 1977 from Happy Institute, Mumbai. And he is serving as a director, Aurobindo Foundation, Pune, director, KLJ Consultants, Pune, and director, NNPC Institute of Pharmacy, Satara. Earlier, he was a principal of Government College of Pharmacy, Karai, and Government College of Pharmacy, Aurangabad. He has published 15 books, 5 book chapters, and 139 journal articles in addition to a patent. He has won several awards, including Principal of the Year Award from APTA in 2019. 3 times he was listed in Marquee World's Who's Who. With this brief background, I invite Professor Satish Bise to tell you the primer of biosimilars. Over to you, sir.
Hello. Yeah. Honorable members of the governing board, NIPER Kolkata, Dr. Ravichandran, director of the institute, and the listeners, I have pleasure in presenting a discussion on primer on biosimilars. If at all we call this a 5-day match, I am the opening batsman, and I have to give you background of the topic and keep the things moving. So the initial thing which I am going to tell you about: what are biosimilars? Why are we interested in it? And if at all somebody has to introduce the product in India, what the company has to do? These 3 points we are going to see. Let's see. May I have the next slide, please? Let's see the learning objectives. Next slide, please. At this end of these sessions, I expect the learners should be able to explain what are biosimilars, the major concept. Then describe why we study biosimilars, and third, the explain what one has to do if product has to be introduced. But before starting with what are biosimilars, let me emphasize the thing that if I don't exaggerate, the coming decade is going to be a decade of biosimilars so far as drugs are concerned, both in India and in Europe, US, Australia, and all over the world. The figures in the market will certainly emphasize what I'm going to say this. But because the coming decade is that of biosimilars, we'll need a lot of man force related to biosimilars. And if at all, we can develop that man force through a postgraduate and doctoral course, both at NIPER Kolkata and NIPER Hazipur, it will be a big contribution to both industry and also the persons learning it. And a good news for all the listeners and those who are interested in biosimilars, that there are enormous opportunities both in India and abroad for biosimilars. So if you enter into this topic as a career, there are good opportunities. With this background, let us start discussing about what are biosimilars. May I have the next slide, please? The first point we are going to do is explain what are biosimilars. Next slide. Let me go to the technical definition. Biosimilars are biologic, they are a biological origin. Medical, that means they are going to be used for clinical use, and they are products just like other synthetic drugs, as simple as that of aspirin. So like aspirin, they are product, they are going to be used for clinical purpose, that's why word medical, and they are of biologic origin, that is why we call them biosimilar. But then you would say, why this word similar? I'm coming to that. So now in this case, biosimilars are biologic medical products whose active drug substance, synthetic drug, we call the active substance as API, active pharmaceutical ingredient, which is relatively simple in structure. But in case of biological molecules, the molecule which is going to have therapeutic action is a bit complicated, mostly it is protein. And they are made by a living organism. That is another characteristic, that initially they are made by a living organism, or now with the advent of genetic engineering, they are derived from a living organism by means of recombinant DNA. Well, all of you are aware of this, but let me just briefly tell. The recombinant DNA technology means, if at all you have a protein known to you, there is certainly a gene related to that protein. So identify that gene in the DNA, you with the use of appropriate enzymes, splice or cut down that DNA, transfer it to appropriate vector, make it acceptable to that vector and put it that in a host. After putting in a host, if you give adequate food to the main cell, bacterial cell or other related cell, then they produce the protein for which DNA has been isolated. This is the recombinant DNA technology, and all biosimilars are derived by this recombinant DNA technology by controlled gene expression methods. One of the example I can give you is insulin, but insulin, now we have two derivatives of insulin in the market, which relatively are longer half-life. People are also trying to have whether we can have a product which can be orally acceptable. Efforts are being done that. But now when the compounds are synthesized as biosimilars, they are similar, but not identical. Identical means all aspects are same. Now, if I give example, even in twins, there may be certain features which are different. So it is difficult to see that two molecules are identical, but with simpler molecules like aspirin, paracetamol, or even antibiotic like amoxicillin, producing the identical molecules is relatively simple. But in complicated molecules, producing an identical molecule is a bit technically difficult, and that is why what we get, if it shows an expected therapeutic action, well, it can be acceptable even if there are small differences, and that's why we are using similar word. So every molecule which is coming in the biosimilar realm may not be identical, but it is similar to what we call as a reference biological. A parent company produces that, they have patent life protection, and once the patent life is over, other cells can produce. So this is about what are biosimilars. Next slide, please. Now, I'm giving a comparison between generics, a word used very commonly for synthetic drugs, biosimilars, and what is similarity or differences between them. So far as production is concerned, the generics are simple and consistent. Let me give you an example of a molecule like paracetamol. Very simple, and every paracetamol molecule is similar. But in case of biosimilars, production is complex and variable because we are using recombinant DNA technology for producing it. And therefore, in case of production, the technologies are different. Now, coming to active product, the active product is always the same in case of generic, that is the simpler molecules, conventional molecules, I would say. In case of biosimilars, the active product is likely to have variation. Maybe variation when we come to proteins, we have primary structure of the protein, secondary structure of the protein, tertiary structure of the protein, and quaternary structure of the protein. So in some of them, maybe in primary, maybe in secondary, tertiary, there may be some difference, and that is how biosimilar products are. The biosimilars are different than that of generic. On one aspect, they are same. Formulation may have some variation in case of generic. And in case of biosimilars also, formulations may have same variation, some variation. Only commonality about all most of the biosimilars are, because they are protein molecules, most of them are to be administered parenterally in the form of a injection. Because given orally, they will not be active because in the gastric content, they may be hydrolyzed. Now, next aspect is same clinical effects can be assumed with generic molecules. If you give paracetamol, the temperature will be reduced. Well, but then same clinical effects cannot be assumed. In biosimilars, we cannot assume because there can be slight variation. Now, so far as that variation is not affecting the clinical response, the molecule is acceptable. We call it the biosimilar and use it. So in this case, there can be some difference in the clinical aspect. You have to take care of it. They are different. Now, the next is regulations. Regulators accept equivalence, and we call that as a bioequivalence. If you take a group of individuals, 12 for 24 or 36, and give a drug and find out its concentration after 1, 2, 4, 6 hours, and find out the graph of the increase difference in concentration versus time. Do the same thing with the molecule produced by another company. If they are superimposable in terms of 80 to 125% area under curve and Tmax and all that, I'm not going to technicality, we call those molecules as bioequivalent. So this is we call in synthetic molecules. But in case of biosimilars, regulators do not accept equivalence because it cannot be assumed. And you have to do a clinical trial every time to prove that the molecule is similar to that of the original product. So this is main difference between generics and biosimilars. Next slide, please. Now, coming all over the world, there are different names for biosimilar. In fact, the word biosimilar, which we are using quite often, is European word. Europeans call that as biosimilar. In India, we call it as similar biologics. So in fact, what I'm going to tell about Indian things, we are in similar biologics to a larger extent. Japan, Brazil, and USA, they call follow-on biologics. World Health Organization calls it as similar biologic therapeutic products. India, similar biologics. Europe, biosimilars. Canada, they call subsequent entry biologics. And in South Africa, they call non-comparable biologics. So nevertheless, whatever may be nomenclature for the term given to the substance, these are biological molecules which are likely to be similar in their action. So this is about what are biosimilar. Next slide, please. Now, coming to types. What are the different types of molecules? They are basically of two categories. One related to blood, which I'm coming to next to this, and others which are not directly related to blood. The first category is that of cytokines. The cells observe the substances obtained from cells, cytokines. So the one of them category is interferons. One of the interferon is now for COVID. Interferon, beta interferon probably is being introduced by Cadila in the market. Interleukins, some chemicals communicate between leukocytes, that is why they are called interleukins. They are then colony stimulating factors. If you grow a bacterial cell, then there may be colonies. And if some chemicals are added, the colony may be stimulated in terms of number. And these factors, they are protein. Therefore, they are called as colony stimulating factors. And then there are tumor necrosis factors. Tumor necrosis factors are quite useful in case of cancer. Cancer develops in the form of a tumor. And if there are factors, necrosis is in breaking down, killing. So if there are some, in fact, there are some proteins which help in breakdown or killing of tumors, which are called as tumor necrosis factor. All of these substances are produced in the body. In fact, this is the defense of the body. And if this defense falls down, now see, whenever you can take this analogy, that when an enemy force can supersede you, only when your support or your protection becomes weak. So body produces interferons, body produces interleukins, body produces CSF, body produces TNFs. And if they are not adequate, in that case, the invading organism or some change in the body may cause the disease. So the cytokines are one of the types of biosimilars. The second category of biosimilars are growth hormones and growth factors. You are well aware of the disease called as cretinism, that some people do not grow in terms of height and all that. They may be just 1 or 2 feet and all life feet. So this is because of the deficiency of a growth hormone. And there are several growth factors related to that. So all of them are proteins in nature. And therefore, growth hormones and growth factors are yet another category of biosimilars. The third category, insulins, I am putting plural. Insulin is a single molecule with 51 amino acids, two chains, one of 30 amino acids, another is 21, and disulfide bridges in that. That is the structure of insulin. But then, two derivatives of insulins are being produced, and therefore I'm putting that as insulin. There are three types of insulins now in market, and they will effort is being produced whether we can have nasal administration of insulin. One company tried it, they are not fully succeeded. Efforts are also being, can we have some form of insulin which can also be orally active, all of the in developmental stage. That's why insulins are yet another category of biosimilars. Now, I put monoclonal antibodies in bold. Dr. Vijayendra has quite often mentioned about these monoclonal antibodies. Whenever antibodies are produced, a clone of cells are developed. And usually, say for example, if I give you example of snake venom, the snake venom contains certain peptides which are toxic and a lot of enzymes. In fact, snake venom is a modified mammary gland. So if you inject that in horses, you get what can be called as polyclonal antibodies. They will neutralize that toxin, they will neutralize the enzymes and all that. Now, if at all want specificity on the action, then instead of polyclonal antibodies, you think of monoclonal antibodies. Only one type of clone of cells will be developed, and they will be combined with a cancerous cell, and at that together is called as a hybridoma. So when a hybridoma is produced with a cancerous cell and a single clone producing cell, you get what are called as monoclonal antibodies. They have to be purified further, and they have a lot of use. In fact, the biggest market in case of biosimilars is that of monoclonal antibodies. In fact, in case of COVID also, we have what people have called as cocktail of antibodies. Some two or three antibodies combined together have been observed to give a good relief within 1 or 2 days for COVID patient. Only thing is, antibodies have to be given at an earlier stage so that the patient would recover. Another important area is that of vaccines consisting of well-characterized proteins. Whenever vaccines are being given, we are also making an effort of n number of types of vaccines for COVID, you are saying. So a lot of vaccines, wherever well-characterized proteins are the factors or polypeptides are involved, they can be produced by recombinant DNA technology, and that the vaccines are also biosimilar. Now, in addition to that, there are few antibiotics, allergenic extract, heparins, and few vitamins we can also come into. So all these are non-blood related products. We have another category of biosimilars. Next slide, please. And these are blood related products. Erythropoietins. Now, many times anemia, that is less number of RBCs, is because of deficiency of vitamin B12, deficiency of iron, deficiency of folic acid. But in addition to that, it is also observed that there are certain proteins called as erythropoietins, which promote the growth of RBCs, and they can be useful. Sometimes even by giving iron, folic acid, and B12, which is usually given for anemia, anemia is not recovered. In that case, the erythropoietins can be given. Then there are plasminogen activators. You are aware of the word plasminogen, which gets plasmin, and blood plasma factors. So all these are blood-related biosimilars. So basically two types of biosimilars, one which several types are, as I have discussed, monoclonal antibodies, growth hormones, and cytokine. And the second category is a blood-related products. Next slide, please. Now, this was about the first objective. Now, the second learning objective we have is describe why at all. Now, you will certainly, well, biosimilars are the entirely derived product and from biological origin, we understood. But why at all we should study biosimilar? Let's come to know about that. Next. Now, next slide, please. Let's know the market about biosimilars. In 2016, 5 years back, in fact, global market, this is one of the reports from this I have collected value. Global market size was 2.2 billion. And from 2.29, this was 16. From 15, which was around same 2.29, it has raised to 6.22, almost three times in 5 years. That is, and what is expected now? I am repeating the word. The coming, it can be called as a biosimilar decade, because it is expected by 2030, the global market is expected to be 240 billion. From existing around say 6 or 7, so which is a good nearly 100 times rise, and that's why there is a lot of scope. The students who are entering into the career should think of biosimilar as the first priority. Expected Indian market at now, when the world market is reaching 240 billion, the Indian contribution is expected to be 35 billion. Comparison I have mentioned, the conversion, that 35 billion comes to 2.6 lakh crores. Right now, our entire turn of synthetic pharmaceutical industry is say 1.5 lakh crores or so. So that if we go ahead, we will have more existing market than the existing than kind of pharmaceutical. Now, another opportunity that once the patent life of a biosimilar is exhausted, other competitive manufacturers who have got capability can enter into the market. And in 2018, biosimilars worth 50 billion were out of patents, and coming years more amount of biosimilars will be coming out of patent. I don't have figure of 2021, but the point is 50 billion patents are drug worth patent are out, and therefore more competitors can enter it. So there is a good market you can know from this. Next slide, please. Now India has been very alert about this, and 14 Indian pharmaceutical companies are active in biosimilars. Maybe few might have been added also. Whatever I'm mentioning, the 14 companies are Biocon in Bangalore, DRL in Hyderabad, Reliance Life Sciences Mumbai, Intas Pharmaceuticals, I think probably Ahmedabad, Zydus Ahmedabad, Cipla Mumbai, Lupin Mumbai, Torrent Gujarat again, Hetero Pharma, Aurobindo, I think Andhra Pradesh, Alkem Mumbai, MQR Pune, IPCA Lab, and Wocard. These 15 companies are active. Some of them have introduced some molecules, some are for some of them our production pipeline. And take it from me that here is the job opportunity for the entrance. You can try any of them, these companies, once you get familiar with biosimilar. And in coming 10 years, there will be a lot of job opportunities coming. Now, in addition to these 15 pharmaceutical companies, there are several what we call as CROs, contract research organizations. Only one aspect we are going to see about different aspects of biosimilar, but in one, some of the CROs may be doing only clinical trials. Some of the CROs may be developing only biological molecules. Some of the CROs may be doing only formulations. Now, currently, there is no exclusive CRO for biosimilars. In world, there are. I don't have names at the moment. But we have CROs for synthetic products, and they are taking up the work for biosimilars. And all of them, both the 15 companies and the CROs, need manpower related to expertise in biosimilars. And in fact, at this point, I have a suggestion that, the commercial private biosimilar somebody will certainly capture, but why not public sector comes up? So I suggest here that Naipur Kolkata and Naipur Hazipur can together become a CRO for biosimilars and have a good opportunity. Next slide, please. Now, in addition to that, there are several global opportunities. Developed countries like USA, EU, and European Union and Japan. Then BRICS countries, Brazil, Russia, India, Canada, and South Africa. Another term is MIST countries, Mexico, Indonesia, South Korea, and Turkey, Australia. All these countries, the developed countries, BRICS, MIST, Australia, they offer lucrative opportunities in biosimilar. And here, one more suggestion that if along with Indian entrepreneurs, there are a lot of global opportunities coming to go into biosimilars. There is a very good potential for exports. Indian people are competent. 15 companies are not only producing biosimilars for them, but they are exporting them. Only cautionary point why there is a limited market in within our own country is the price. When the price becomes affordable, Indians also will be using biosimilars to a larger extent. Now, some of the monoclonal antibodies have a potential in the treatment of COVID-19 also. So these are the opportunities coming for this, and that's why we should study biosimilar. Now, next slide, please. We come to the third objective, which is a relatively bigger one, that explain what one has to do to introduce a similar biologic in Indian market. All these 15 companies, we have put product in the market, they have done the things which are now I'm going to some technical aspect, the regulatory aspect related to biosimilars in India, because when we are working in India, we should know what Indian government or Indian entrepreneurs need. Next slide, please. Now, briefly, I am telling you about regulatory guidelines from India. In India, we call it as similar biologics. So there are guidelines on similar biologics, and there are regulatory requirements for marketing authorization in India to develop the molecule and marketing authorization. For two things, you have to approach the government. There are different agencies. I am coming to come there. Indian government have been so alert that there have been revisions. First, the regulatory guidelines were developed in 2012, and they have been revised in 2016 in consultation with industry. A lot of industry experts have participated in the development of guidelines for Indian sector. Now, there are two departments involved in the development of biosimilars: Department of Biotechnology and the Drug Controller through CDSCO, that is Central Drug Standardization and Control Organization, are involved. The final permission to market till the developmental stage, Department of Biotechnology may be involved. And final permission for marketing any biosimilar is given by the Drug Controller General of COVID vaccine US in recently. And this guideline, which I'm going to discuss, is effective in India from August 15, 2016. Let's see what are the details. Next slide. Now I'm going to see, next slide, salient features of this Indian guideline. There are different competent authorities from both these departments. I will give names of list of them. Then there are principles of development. There are data requirements. There are three phases as in case of synthetic drug. Preclinical stage. So there are some data requirements to be developed or got for preclinical studies. Then data requirements for clinical trial application. You have to conduct a clinical trial in India to show that the product is comparable to that of reference biologic. And there are data requirements for marketing authorization. So preclinical, clinical, and marketing authorization. But then just by permission, things are not over. Once you start marketing the product, you have also to collect a lot of information, what we call it as pharmacovigilance for these substances, and that is post-marketing surveillance or data related to that. So these are the salient features which we are going to discuss. Next slide, please. Next slide. Now let's come to what are competent authorities in India. There are competent authorities in India for biosimilars. Institutional Biosafety Committee, all of us who are involved in handling animal experiments are aware about Animal Ethics Committee in the institution. Now similarly, the institution, any institution, take it any NIPER or take it any, say, any institute like Indian Institute of Chemical Biology or maybe IIT Biological Section, they will have an Institutional Biosafety Committee, IBSC, to do whatever they are doing, the permission of that biosafety. It is an in-house authority. Just like the clinical trial, there is Ethics Committee. Similarly, we have a Biosafety Committee. Now, the second authority is Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation. Now, whenever genetic manipulations are done, I caution here that genetic manipulations are done not only for biosimilars, but they are primarily done for the agricultural products. And therefore, here is the issue come. We have genetically modified foods. And this committee, Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation, looks if by genetic manipulation nothing adverse has been done, the product produced is safe and all that. Then we have Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. Now the Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee means whenever you are doing genetic engineering, that is transforming a gene from the main source to another host cell, there the techniques which are followed in that have to be acceptable, and therefore to know that Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. So first, institutional committee is within the institution. Second, RCGM and GESC are within the Department of Biotechnology, and another department. Finally, having done entire research and all that, you come to CDSCO, Central Drug Standard, for the final permission. So these are four competent authorities for controlling the activities related to biosimilars. Next slide, please. Now, let us discuss each one of them. Selection of reference biologic. These are the principles of it. You have to select which reference biologic you are, whether it is insulin, whether it is a colony stimulating factor, whether it is a monoclonal antibody, what it is. So selection of reference biologic is the first issue the company has to look for. Then they have to control manufacturing process. They have to look for quality-based consideration, and they have to look for quality compatibility study. Each one we are discussing in some details. I mean, just a bird's eye view. So let's come to selection of reference biologic. Now, next slide, please. Whenever a biosimilar is being produced, next slide, we have what is called as reference biologic. Next slide. Reference biologic is the product which is by the initial company, the company which has got a patent. Next slide. The reference biologic should be licensed. So maybe some another company in US or Australia or Europe might have developed. So this reference biologic should be licensed or approved either in India or ICH, in International Conference on Harmonization. See, just not a big detailing, but introduction let me give to the word ICH, that around 90% of the market of new drugs is controlled by two continents and one country. That country is Japan, one continent, Europe, and another country is USA. So USA, Japan, and Europe together control at least 80 to 90% of the market. So the manufacturers from these countries came together and said that if at all we have some understanding by which the studies done in one region or one country are accepted in others, other manufacturers need not repeat the entire studies and can save money. So ICH harmonization rules, and then finally WHO or other countries also accept ICH norms. So the reference biologic should be approved in India or ICH countries and should be the innovator's product. As it is very well known that the pharmaceuticals as well as biosimilars developed much more. Now, in fact, Europe is the pioneer in that. US followed to Europe. Next was USA. Then primarily Japan, Australia, and other countries. So Europe is the pioneer in this. The reference biologic should be licensed based on full safety, efficacy, and quantity data. Then the second characteristic, in case of reference biologic, if the reference biologic is not marketed in India and only in, say, Europe and US, then the reference biologic should have been licensed in any, it should have been licensed in that country, wherever it is original. It should be marketed, either Europe or US. The reference biologic product can be imported for developing similar biologic quality preclinical. It can be imported in course of time. You can develop that product also. Next slide, please. Next slide. Now, in selection, the same reference biologic should be used throughout the study, supporting the safety, efficacy, and quality of the product. As I have been telling quite often, a slight change in the protein can have enormous difference. So, the same substance of origin should be used. The dosage form, strength, and route of administration of the similar biologic should be same as that of route of administration also should be same. The active drug substance, that the active ingredient of the reference biologic and that of similar biologic must shown to be similar, and you have to demonstrate that they are similar. So this is about selecting the reference biologic. Next slide, please. Production. Next slide. Production, in fact, is a big process. I am not going into details of everything, but just tell you, develop the host cell. The cell will produce, whether it is yeast or E. coli or something. Develop a host cell, then establish a cell bank. Take the gene, splice that gene, they shift it to the host cell, and lest host cell accept that. Well, till then, it is not called a host cell. So it's at accept. So you have to establish a cell bank, which when it grows, produces a biosimilar. Then by fermentation, we have to have protein production. That protein may have a lot of contaminants which may come in the process. So you have to purify that. You have to analyze that. Purification is not, you analyze and find out there are no contaminants remaining in that. Then you have to formulate that in an injectable form. And the product manufacturer, here one more question. If you have a feeling that you have produced a protein and you can relax, no, there are issues related to storage and handling. One of the important issues is aggregation of the product. Another important issue is there is a glycosylation of the product. So storage and handling are also important factors. And these seven factors are to be controlled whenever production is to be controlled and in a reproducible manner. This slide is not a part of a regulatory thing, but this I have added just to ease out our discussion. Next slide, please. Now, coming to manufacturing process, there are three components. Molecular biology considerations, so far as the protein is considered, how much is its molecular weight, how it is getting folded, what are the characteristics of tertiary structure, quaternary structure, and so on. Then upstream process development, that is, till the product is generated on the larger scale. There are a lot of things to be done. So upstream, I'm coming to each one of them in some detail. And then downstream, once the product has been manufactured, till the isolation, analysis, characterization, and formulation, these are downstream processes. Let's see each one of them. Molecular biology, next slide, please. Now in molecular biology, the details regarding host cell cultures, including viral clearance. The virus may contaminate in the cell culture, so should not be any virus contamination. Vectors which you use, gene sequences, promoters. Each substance is a different. If you are just familiar with these words, vectors, gene sequences, promoters, it's enough right now. You can go into, say, Wikipedia for getting the details and all that. Used in the production of similar biologics should be provided with appropriate drawings and figures. So all components, vectors, gene sequences, promoters should be. Then detail of post-translation, as I just now said, there are a lot of post-translational modifications, glycosylation, oxidation, deamidation, phosphorylation, etc. If at all they are happening, they should be explained in molecular biology term. Next slide, please. Now, having known about molecular biology content of the protein, let us come to upstream process till we manufacture the drug to a larger content. Details including media components. Which media you use? Are there any? What are the components in that? What are the characteristics for that? If there are no contaminants in the components of media. So details of the media. Then at least three batches of reproducible fermentation data. You have to generate three batches. In fact, the manufacturer has to be competent. They have a team of people. So they have to prepare three independent batches on pilot scale and show that the data is reproducible. Then details of upstream process. Now, when the cells are multiplying and feed is giving to them, a lot of things are happening. What we call as kinetics data from consistency batches indicating cell growth, product formation, pH, temperature. Now all these parameters may change when the cells are changing, so you have to maintain them in the optimal limit. Dissolved oxygen, major nutrient consumption pattern, and agitation rate. So these are some of the factors. My objective here is just you should know what are the kinds of variables. Now the next is concentration to be defined in terms of product per liter, yield, and volumetric productivity. How much time it has taken, how much product is there per liter, what is the capacity and all that. Next slide, please. Now, upstream, there are some more details. That data to verify that the specific protein yield, amount of protein per unit mass remains constant. So, amount of the final product is protein and your cell mass in terms of grams. So, how many protein, how much quantum of protein is generated? Every batch, that should be consistent within the limits of variation, plus or minus some, and demonstrate the overall product is reproducible and scalable, exactly reproducible, and you can generate on the large. These are the upstream processes till the product is manufactured on the large scale. Next slide, please. Now coming to downstream process, once the product is developed, further purification, detailed description of the methods followed for the cell harvesting and extraction of the protein. Steps involved in purification of the, once you make the protein, you have to purify that. Then batch size of purine purification. Now you are away from the living cells and you are purifying the protein and removing the contaminants. The description of each unit operation step during purification and recovery of protein along with quantitative recovery product at each stage has to be mentioned. All these data has to be given to the controlling authorities. Next slide, please. There are a few more things in downstream. Describe the quantity of the threshold refolded protein. The protein gets refolded if the starting material is aggregated or from inclusion bodies, and include details of the refolding process. There are issues when you come to quaternary structure of the protein. There are foldings of the protein. So how protein is getting folded? Is it changing the activity? Specific activity at different doses. Dose response curve, stability data. And confirmation of stability and absence of aggregation. The molecule should not aggregate because if they aggregate, it may affect the function. Then the another parameter is consistency of recovery in three consecutive batches of purification. From we have been observing, every time they say that you have to produce three batches, show that the product is stable and go further. Next slide, please. Now, having seen the manufacturing part downstream, there are a few more details. Describe post-translational variation. As I have seen, there can be glycosylation, deamidation, oxidation, etc., aggregation of the protein. Details of removal impurities like product-related variants. Some contaminants may come. As in case of synthetic drug, we have impurities. there can be anything other than the main protein which you are targeting will be labeled as a impurity. And as we come to know, there are issues of immunogenicity by protein itself, and the contaminants may add to immunogenicity. So that's why they have to be done. Virus clearance validation studies. If at all there are any viruses, their contamination should be avoided and it should be validated. This is about the manufacturing process, upstream and downstream. Next slide, please. Now we come to good manufacturing practices data submission. Having produced this, you have generated the protein, you have purified the protein, you have analyzed the protein, you have to collect all this GMP data and submit it to regulatory authority, especially CDSCO. Detailed description of the drug substance and the product process, critical and key quality attributes of the product, manufacturing process controls, pH, temperature, and all that, critical process parameters, if there are any, stability data, and comparability of the product manufactured at clinical scale against. Now, all these should be similar to that of reference biology. And all these data from three batches consistency is to be shown to the regulatory authorities. Submit them. Next slide, please. Now, we have come to a stage, we have produced the substance. Now, there comes the issue of quality. So, in this case, it comes to quality-based considerations. We talk about analytical methods, we talk about product characterization, specifications, and stability. Wherever I underline the topic, I am giving some further details of that. So, let's come to analytical methods now. Next slide, please. Now, analytical methods, the methods used to measure quality attributes. Well, you have produced a protein. Does it, is it similar to that of reference biology? Yeah, but they have to be parameters. So, stability studies in process control should be validated in accord. And for this, fortunately, the International Conference of Harmonization, IICH, has given guidelines. ICH-Q2, ICH-5C, and ICH-6B. ICH-2SU, now R1 refers to, there are revisions in that. So first revision for Q2 has come, and the first ICH-Q2, R1, talks about validation of analytical procedures, text and methodology. ICH-5QC talks about stability testing of biotechnology and biological products. And ICH-Q6B talks about specifications, test procedures, and acceptance criteria for, now these are exclusive things for biological products in general and biosimilars in particular. So much so about analytical methods. Next slide, please. Now coming to product characterization. Structural and physicochemical properties. Well, protein has a structure, primary structure, and quaternary structure. So that physicochemical parameters, properties related to that, especially by spectroscopic techniques, have to be observed. Then you have to demonstrate biological activity. Say, for example, we have developed erythropoietin. So what is the biological activity of erythropoietin? Promote hemoglobin formation and promote RBC growth. So that has to be demonstrated. Then one of the key factors in case of biosimilars is immunological properties. If at all the biosimilar which you are introducing becomes immunogenic to the person it has been given, over the period of time, antibodies will be developed and the effect of biosimilar will wane off. So that should not happen. So therefore, immunological properties. And then we have to see about purity and impurity. Let's see some details. Structural property, biological activity, I mentioned. Let's see about purity and impurity. Next slide, please. Now, in case of purity and impurities, product-related variants. There are variants of the product, glycoform. Some fraction of that biosimilar may be glycosylated. You are well aware about glycosylation in case of diabetic persons. It creates a higher level of glycosylated hemoglobin, which we use the parameters to know how the patient has behaved in the last 3 months. So we have different glycoforms of biosimilars. We have isomers of biosimilars. Maybe one amino acid may be differing, but and they are isomers. Now, product-related, there can be product-related impurities. That is aggregated, oxidized, or deamidated product. In course of time, during storage, in the conditions, the product may get aggregated, product may get oxidized because of the aerial oxidation, or it may get deamidated. Then host cell related impurities. You are using one host cell, either say E. coli or one of the yeast. or may something more in that, they may also add some impurities. So host cell protein, host cell DNA, we don't want them. We want only that protein which is of our interest, biosimilar. Then process related impurities, so product related impurities, host cell related impurities, and process related impurities, residual media components, resin, leaches, etc., they may come. They have, you have to take care of these. Next slide, please. Now next we come to quality comparability study. That means the quality is the product is compatible when administered in human being. There are critical quality attributes, we call it as CQA, which have impact on clinical safety and efficacy. Now every time I am emphasizing that if clinical safety and efficacy is altered, the entire purpose is defeated. It should not alter. So you have to look for which are quality attributes which are related to safety and efficacy. Then there are key quality attributes. They have no impact on clinical effects and safety, but are considered relevant from a product and a process consistency point of view. So quality attributes, key and critical. Critical are involved for clinical efficacy, and key are involved for stability and overall process. Next slide, please. Now we come to data, which is to be submitted to regulatory authorities like CDSCO before getting permission. And there are three factors: preclinical studies, pharmacodynamic and pharmacokinetic, and immune response. So this is about preclinical, three aspects: prerequisites, then pharmacodynamics and toxicology, and immune response in animals, which we have to clear and do these studies. Next slide, please. Now prerequisites for next slide. Basic information about the reference biologic should be available, and basic information about similar biologics also should be available, and that should be compared. And if it is comparable, then you can go ahead. Next slide, please. Reference biologic. Now in case of reference biologic, information about the drug, route of administration, absorption, elimination rate, therapeutic index, dose, vehicle, mode of administration, dose response score, all these should be known. Bioequivalence range, if available, usually in synthetic products it is 80 to 120%. Then tissue specific localization, are they going to only one kind of tissue, say only some cells in kidney, only some cells in bone marrow, only some cells in liver, or so on. And then available toxicity data on reference biology and mode of action. This information about reference biologic, that is the parent molecule which was developed by the company which has got a patent, should be available. Next slide, please. Now coming to similar biologics. Next slide. Known or proposed clinical use, what for you are going to use? Are you going to use for all population, or you are restricting some target population, age, sex? Can it be given safely to pregnant mothers? Can it be given safely to lactating mothers? Can it be given to pediatric patients, and so on? So what is the target population? Then dosage, frequency and intervals, how much time and how much quantity, route of administration, and are there any alternative routes of administration? Then final formulation plus adjuvants, additives, etc. And remember here, the we call adjuvants as clinically safe, but sometimes it is not true. The adjuvants, additives also may have toxicity, and therefore toxicological data for adjuvants has to be given. Which diluents you have used, presentation, whether are you giving in a prefilled syringe, cartridge, or vial, all these data for similar biologics has to be submitted. Next slide, please. Now coming to pharmacodynamic studies. Next slide. In vitro studies and in vivo studies. Next slide. Now in vitro studies, as you are very well aware, in vitro studies are those. Next slide, please. Outside the body, maybe a test tube, I would say. Next slide. Earlier to this pharmacodynamic, right? In vitro studies to know comparability of similar biologic and reference biologic should be established by in vitro based bioassay, cell proliferation and cytotoxicity. So you, and if in vitro shows competence of the substance, fine. If in vitro is not showing that, only then in vivo studies are done. So wherever in vitro assays do not reflect the pharmacodynamics, in vivo studies should preferably be done. Next slide, please. Then we come to toxicological study. The study groups of animals, it has to be done because it is toxicological, it has to be done in animals. So it consists of 7 to 8 groups I'm not listing them. Then details of protocols and histopathological studies defined. And we are known these agency, controlling agencies, RCGM, IBSC, IAAC, approval from them for conduct before conducting toxicology studies, just like, and your, of course, animal ethics committee, and quality assessment statement has to be given. This is about toxicology studies. Next. Now we come to immune response in animals. As I have been saying, all biosimilars are proteins, and therefore, there theoretically there is a possibility that if this biosimilar protein is treated by the body as a foreign protein, antibodies may be produced. So this test had to be done in animals. That antibody response to be compared with reference biologic. Reference biologic give to animals, give similar biologic to animals, and find out if both are same. Immunogenicity testing included to be included as a part of subchronic related dose study. We do acute toxicity studies like LD50, subacute toxicity, and chronic studies. So in subacute, subchronic rather studies, immunogenicity study should be done. Now there are three special studies which are done for synthetic biologicals quite often. They are not that relevant for biosimilars because the substances are of natural origin. So teratogenicity, mutagenicity, and carcinogenicity studies are not usually included. Teratogenicity refers to the adverse effects on the fetus. Mutagenicity refers to mutation in the biological cell causing some variation, and carcinogenicity refers to cancer causing property. And all these data is to be submitted. RCGM reviews that. Next slide, please. Now, we come to clinical trial. So we have pharmacokinetic studies, pharmacodynamic studies, confirmatory safety and efficacy studies, safety and immunogenicity data. Now this is in human beings, and extrapolation of safety and efficacy data to other indications. Pharmacodynamics is related to the action, which is desirable. For example, in case of erythropoietin, you expect RBC count to increase, more amount of hemoglobin. So that is also, I'm discussing about pharmacokinetic studies and confirmatory safety data. Next slide, please. Now coming to pharmacokinetic studies, there are design considerations, single dose PK studies, and multiple dose PK studies. Next slide, please. Now in design considerations, normal healthy volunteers and patients, both are to be administered. What are the factors for design considerations? Half-life of the biosimilar, linearity of pharmacokinetic parameters, endogenous levels, and diurnal variations, mean time dependent variations. Some hormones, for example, are high in morning time, they may be less in afternoon time, and then they may be again less in the evening. Some hormones for which are producing sleep, for example, may be higher in the night time. So time dependent changes in daytime are called as diurnal variation. So are there any diurnal variations in the biosimilar? Conditions and diseases to be treated, and routes of administration, these factors, and in the design, whether it is single dose, comparative, parallel arm, or crossover. Parallel arm means two different groups at different times, and crossover means same group after some time. Then multiple dose, comparative parallel arm study. These are the considerations which you have to think of while designing the clinical trial. Next slide, please. Now, in case of single dose, the single dose and multiple dose studies are to be done. Within therapeutic, the dose should be in therapeutic range. You have to use the same route of administration, sample size as per statistical advice. You cannot select the number of patients only because of financial consideration. You have to take the statistical advice based on the variables. You have to select the number of patients. Comparability limits to be justified. Analytical method validation, degradation product, if any, and differences in the elimination kinetics, a parallel arm or crossover study. These are the factors to be considered in single dose. Next slide, please. Now coming to pharmacodynamic action, comparative parallel arm or crossover pharmacodynamic study. Now here there is one question: is there any pharmacodynamic marker? What do I mean by, if I give you example of diabetes, you can very well understand that glucose level is a marker of diabetes. If glucose level is high, that means you are diabetic consideration. Now if every time for a biosimilar, there may or may not be a pharmacodynamic marker. What action it is producing? For example, I'm repeatedly giving the same example, erythropoietin. If at all erythropoietin is given, what is the pharmacodynamic marker? Increase in hemoglobin content and increase in RBCs. And if such a direct marker is not available, is there a surrogate marker? Is something which is related to that, which we can measure. Direct marker may not be known, but a surrogate means related marker, which have indirect relation to the effect. And if both are not there, then it may be combined with phase 3 studies. If there, you can only study the marker. Advantage with marker is that based on marker, you can control or you can know what is the stage of the disease. If not, go for surrogate marker. If not, then go for clinical effect. And then the parameters should be clinically relevant. These are pharmacodynamic considerations. Next, confirmatory safety and efficacy studies. Comparative phase 3 studies recommended. You need not do phase 1, phase 2, and you can go phase 3 directly. Sensitive and homogeneous patient population should be taken. Equivalence, non-inferiority, and comparability investigation should be done. Nature, severity, and frequency of adverse drug reaction. Another factor, sometimes you may observe some adverse drug reactions. Are they related to biosimilars? And what are the adverse reactions? Are they serious or non-serious? Then adequately powered randomized parallel group. Blinded clinical safety and efficacy trials are suggested. Next slide, please. Now, after this, next slide, we come to phase 3 study. Now, in this case, there is a relief to manufacturers. There is a factor of waiver of safety and efficacy study under certain conditions. That 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm not listing those conditions. But if some conditions are followed, the phase 3 study may be waived off and you can go for direct clinical application. Non-comparative safety and efficacy study. So these are the factors related to phase 3. Next. Now, next slide. Safety and immunogenicity. Immunogenicity is equally important in case of clinical trials. Comparative, now we do carry out animal studies, but sometimes animals may not show immunogenicity, but human beings may show. So comparative pre-approval safety data, including immunogenicity in phase 3 is waived off. Number of patients, minimum 100, and number of patients in phase 4, dependent on phase 3 outcome, can be 300. Number of patients decide the cost of the study. That's why I'm mentioning that. So this is about safety and immunogenicity. Next, we come to extrapolation of this. Next slide, please. Extrapolation of these studies to human being. The similarity with respect to quality has been proven to reference biologic. You can extrapolate and use the reference biologic. Similarity with respect to preclinical assessment has been proven to reference biologic. Well, you can extrapolate. Clinical safety and efficacy is proven. Well, you can extrapolate means you can use that information for these regulatory submissions and assume that your product is more similar to that of reference biology. Mechanism of action is same, involved receptors are same, and new indications. Now, if at all new indications you are proposing, for example, a monoclonal antibody was developed earlier, but COVID was not known that time. Now you are using this antibody for COVID, so new indication has come. But although safety of that monoclonal antibody has been proved, if at all you are going to use for new indication, that is COVID, you have to conduct a clinical trial. So in new indications not mentioned in innovator need separate application. In fact, you have to make a separate application. For example, if trastuzumab or any of the monoclonal antibodies, any of the Indian companies want to use for COVID, they have to make a separate application to the DCGI. Next slide, please. Now, this is not enough. Once your product start marketing, we call a pharmacovigilance plan. That what are the possibilities? You have to monitor it for a certain known years, 3 years, 5 years, or and so on. So are there any adverse effects? You have to record that. And that is why pharmacovigilance is extremely important in terms of biosimilars. So you have to have a pharmacovigilance plan. You have to have adverse drug reaction reporting, because over the period of time, as the adverse drug reactions may be reported, they may have to be included in the dossier. And a caution here, there may be variation. I am telling one example of a synthetic drug, subacute myelooptic neuropathy for hydrochlorhydroxyquinoline was observed only in Japanese patients. It was not observed in Indian patients. So some variety of patients may show some adverse effects. Indian patients may show possibly if they are to be recorded. Then post-marketing studies, a phase 4 study, and archiving of the entire data has to be archived. Put now with the electronic submission, things have become similar. You can archive the entire data. And another important thing is you have to retain the samples at a low temperature where the product is stable. Because if at all we find any adverse reactions, are they because of the change in the structure, should be known. That is why samples have also to be retained. Now, finally, next. We are coming to the end of discussion. Third, there are certain issues which you should be aware. Issues, differences in the manufacturing process. What is the way it has been manufactured in Europe and the way it is being manufactured in India, in terms of temperature, in terms of oxygen concentration, in terms of humidity, may be different. And although all they are being done in air-conditioned atmosphere, you can try to minimize. But are there any differences in manufacturing processes? What is the quality of product that may vary? Whether the product is stable in terms of aggregation, or 2-3 parameters which I have mentioned: glycosylation, deamidation, oxidation, etc., activity, potency, and safety. These are the issues which may vary between your similar biologic and reference biologic, and can create a problem. So the entrepreneurs have to be aware of this. Clinical application, interchange. Now, I have not discussed about interchangeability, that in case of synthetic drug, one brand can be replaced by another brand. That is what we call as interchangeability for synthetic drug. Now, there is a hesitation. If the patient is stabilized on one kind of biosimilar, doctors have hesitation. But then, if enough proof of safety is given, you can change the biosimilar and there is interchangeability. Then regulatory aspects, monitoring and pharmacovigilance, we have just mentioned about price and marketing. So these are some of the issues. I'm not assuming or telling that this is the end of the issues. There are many more issues. Some issues which have come to my mind, I have mentioned. So with all this, now let us come to the entire summary of our discussion. Next slide, please. Similar biologics are the substances. All this discussion should have conveyed you that similar biologics are the substances of biologic origin used for therapeutic purpose. They are a biologic origin. They are generated from genetic techniques, recombinant technology. There is enormous potential for similar biologics in India and abroad. Indian entrepreneurs can exploit the opportunity for future use. Training of manpower in similar biologics is essential. I highlight this point because this is the purpose for which we propose to introduce biosimilar as a master's and even doctoral course, maybe both at NIPER Kolkata and Hazipur. So a lot of manpower is going to be needed in turning coming decade, and for training people for all the aspects, especially how the product is introduced in India and what needs to be done is to be done. And the Indian regulatory guidelines are self-explanatory. Enough has been mentioned. The only limitation of Indian guidelines is that in Europe and US there are product specific guidelines. One single product, for example, erythropoietin, separate guideline for not all, but many of them. Interferons, for example, alpha interferon, a separate guideline. Now, such product-specific individual guidelines have yet not been developed in India, and that is the potential. If some of you happen to go in DCGI, think of developing regulatory guidelines for individual biosimilar products. So this is all. I think this discussion should have at least brushed up your idea about what biosimilars are and why they are important and why we should study them and what should be done, which data should be submitted if it is to be introduced in the Indian market. Thank you.